Thank you for the, to the organizers to invite me to explain our work. Mainly, I'm going to tell you about the small RNA pipeline that we implement in BCBio. I work in the bioinformatics core at Harvard Chan School. And so what is a small RNA? So it's a very tiny, tiny molecules, 18 to 40 nucleotides long. And they normally, like the most well-known, have a very important function in gene regulation. They do that by binding to the transcript and stop translation, so the protein levels will decrease. An example of the of a small RNA, so microRNA is the most well type of a small RNA. And for instance, in this case, there is a, you see a specific neuron cell type. And when you don't have LET7, that is one of the microRNA that is involved in neural regeneration. So you have the axon outgrown, but when you put the LET7 there, it will stop. It's just because it targeted an important gene that is involved in that. So they have pretty cool important function. And what I want to tell you about the microRNAs is that they're similar to genes in the term of diversity. So you don't have like only microRNA. It's the same that isoforms to genes. You have a diversity there, and they are called isomers. Morin et al. Named that in 2010. So from the precursor that is at the bottom line, normally you can get two mature microRNA, but you don't get always the same sequence. You get some variability at the beginning, at the end. And at the beginning it was thought that it was noise, but actually the expression of these different isoforms vary, depending if you look at different species or different cell types in the same species or different condition. So it's like, depending on what the cell is in which moment, you will have a top express one or another. Other kind of small RNA are the ones that come from tRNA. That actually, I think that has been seen the last 2 years after the sequencing technology appeared. So you see here in the orange box a 20 nucleotide tRNA, small tRNA. You can see that it's quite expressed at the beginning. And these cells are cancer cell types, but not that much expressed in the normal cells. So people is starting to study what they are, if they are cause, consequence, or maybe are involved some way that. And I think that this is the reason why sequencing small RNA is pretty important, because you can see more, not only the microRNA, and you can detect anything that is in your cells. So we try to address some of the challenges that I think that we have in the small RNA analysis. One is the isomer detection. And here I'm referring, like, I like to have all the possible sequence that I have for each microRNA, not just one microRNA and the expression, because I think that it's good to know exactly what is expressed there. Another issue, it could be the multi-mapped reads, that it can be very high in some cell types. And not all of them are just coming from repeat elements. There are many coming from the tRNA. And if you don't analyze that, you are throwing away that data, and maybe you're missing something important. We try to put some visualizations just to help to maybe differentiate between degradation or functional molecules, or try to see in the in a downstream analysis what you want to focus on, because it's true that sometimes you, for instance, have a small RNA for the ribosomal gene, and it's over all the gene, and maybe you want to ignore that, but then focusing some tRNA that actually have a pretty cool gene expression pattern. And then, for sure, if you have a well-annotated genome, you will get all the different results from different types of small RNA, but if it's a non-model organism or it's a pretty new genome, you still can get some results from BCBio, so at least you will get a general characterization. So I started in the bioinformatics core 2 years ago. I learned about BCBio, super great. Brad likes to define that like the white box as an opposite of black box. I put the rainbow there, like the Bosque logo this year. And the idea to say that is because you actually can look into that, see the code, see what command line run each moment, all the logs, what happens. So, and it's open source, it's in GitHub, and that is the idea of the Wattbox software. I'm not going to list all the dependencies here, obviously Bio, but we are using like around 200 different peer review tools, and we install this through Bioconda. Thank you, because we reduce a lot of the installation bugs that we got in GitHub since we started to use Bioconda, so yeah. And I add the small RNA-seq because it's what I have been doing the past 7 years, and I thought it was a cool opportunity to share with people and maybe create a community behind that. There's three different steps, mainly, in the analysis. So the first is the processing of the sequence and do some quality control metrics. I use CUDADAP for trimming and FastAQC, QualiMap, and MultiQC for reporting. The detection and annotation of known small RNA, I use these two tools, MIR-Aligner and TDR-Mapper for microRNA and tRNA. And then for the novo, or general characterization, I use SeqCluster and MIRDIP2 for microRNA. I would like to add for piRNA that this other kind of small RNA. If anybody knows someone that wants to help on that, I would be happy to work with them. So for the detection annotation, the pipeline is pretty straightforward. So you trim your reads, you collapse it, and then you use one or another tool to get the expression of the microRNA or the tRNA. And for microRNA, there is another package that actually allow you to do very good downstream analysis like clustering, differential expressions, some visualization for isomers. For the de novo detection, the only difference is that we collapse all samples into one and map to the genome just to get more coverage because we are detecting new things. And then after that, we generate again the expression for each of the things that have been detected for each type, each sample. For sure, there are some kind of visualization and downstream analysis that you can do. I want to mention what SeqCluster does, because it's a tool that can deal with multi-mapped reads. And the idea, and this is a pretty easy example, but the idea is that you have four different sequences that map in the exact same position, like in two different positions of the genome, but they are the same. This could happen if you have two copies of the same tRNA, right? So what you will get is only one time this, and it's called MetaCluster to have some name. And this is good because it allows you to use the same tools that you use for many other things because you are only calling one time this repetitive sequence. There are some visualizations you can have with the output of SeqCluster. So this is a HTML that you can download to your computer, and you just upload the file from the tool. And you will have the list of the metaclusters, and you can select them. You can do queries, like filter by name or the ID that you will have in the table. And then for each metacluster, you have the position where they map on the genome. You have the profile over the precursor. You can change the color of some samples that can help you to maybe differentiate between groups of samples. You can play with the secondary structure, and it will help you to say to see if it's maybe a good precursor or not. And then you have the table with all the expression for each sequence, and it's interactive and all that. So I think that this helps the people to browse the data. As well, we use for reporting MultiQC that this guy Phil created and is the developer. And I think that is a pretty good tool because it's a Python package. You only care about the parsing of the summary statistic that some tools have, and just create the right data structure, and then MultiQC will put the table on the figure, is interactive, and do many things. So I encourage to any that is working with reporting to just look at it into that because it's quite good. We like to validate, or at least to check that our pipeline is not doing crazy things with data, or at least not randomly. So I'm using data from this project that actually that was done to compare different experimental quantification machines or platforms like arrays and sequencing. But it can be used for comparing tools because at the end there are different samples. So I'm using showing here only four samples. There are more. There are mainly two different samples, A and B, and then they created artificial samples where C has more from B and D has more from D. So in principle, if a molecule is higher expressed in A than B, then this condition, it should be true. A bigger than D, than C, than B, and the opposite in the other way. So we can use that to quantify your microRNA, novel microRNAs, and say, okay, how many times this is true. For microRNA, just removing the very low expressed microRNA actually was good, like more than 90% of the time in both of the ways that we can count this. And the same happened with the clusters. The same happened with MIRDIP2, like to detect novel microRNA that I didn't put here. I need to work a little bit more in the tRNA just because the quantification needs to be fixed a little bit. BCBio took like 9 hours to run all the tools for 8 samples because the project had more samples that I don't show here. And mainly like cluster and MIRDIP2 were the ones that took more time. And then an annotation step, you have the tRNA and the microRNA tool. I want to mention that some friends, college, and I are trying to start an open project. The idea of this is to try to get people together and work together, because for instance, for isomer, still there is no standard naming for that, and it was discovered in 2007. So everybody is doing whatever, like, or ignore it, or only give some of them, or whatever they want. So we are working on that right now. So if you know someone, or you yourself know about microRNA or small RNA, just maybe join it. Or if you are a developer, that would be great as well. And I want to thank the group, the Bioinformatic Core, that I learned a lot in 2 years. They are super smart, super great people. And as well, the research computer at Harvard Medical School, because they are the ones that are maintaining the cluster and the storage. So it's a pretty cool job that they are doing there. And of course, the authors that put the data available, without them, I couldn't validate the pipeline. So thank you for you to listen.